the day will come when the only government on the face of the earth will be the government of Jesus, even politically. You pray in the Holy Ghost to recalibrate your spirit to exactly where the Spirit of God is. You study the Bible to know the Lord and to know how to walk with Him. You must have some scriptures that when you say them in your mouth, it lightens you up. When you have met with the Lord through the study of the Word of God, your spirit is fed. There is a discernment that you live in almost by default. You are the spiritual man that judges all things and yet is judged by no one.
Concerning our preparation and our outcome as to determine whether or not we can drive on roads made by men, it is worthy of our consideration that when our journey on earth is over, we are going to be evaluated by the King Eternal for the precision and the accuracy of our life on earth in agreement with scriptures. So our life should not be lived daily carelessly. If you see Christians that are playing, wasting the grace of God, taking the grace of God for granted, living carelessly, frustrating grace, living in the nursery of the doctrines of the kingdom. Nursery simply means that they have refused to grow. They are excited about forgiveness from sin, that they continue to live daily sinful lives and continue to repent. So they don't mature to be able to partner with God for the recovery and the final redemption of mankind. So although they are God's children, but they are not members of the army, an active army that is doing damage to the kingdom of darkness. You need to understand also that God, like in the natural, you don't take children to war. Now, in the spirit, it does not mean that children are not part of or participant in the battle. They cannot fight. They are liabilities, but they are involved in warfare. A believer that has refused to grow, a believer that has refused to mature, a believer that is not growing in grace and in understanding to, you know, to co-labor with God, is not exempted from warfare. He's still part of warfare, but is a liability largely. The Lord will have to be doing, you know, the intercession of Jesus continues to go on behalf of that child of God. The Lord will have to shield that child of God through the maturity and the effectiveness of other saints who have chosen a deliberate walk with God. So he's a liability, he's a burden, because he has refused to grow. And I want to say to you that, yeah, it's very important that our journey as God's children, we are, there is a cross-check of our actions, our decisions, the information we run our life by. We must cross-check it with the scriptures to ensure that we are preparing effectively to meet the Lord, so that when we see Him, we are not going to be disappointed, because many are going to be shocked. So I believe that in the recent times, the Lord is reminding me to do everything I do against the background, the backdrop of the final instructions He gave to us. I should be mindful of that context when I preach. In Matthew chapter 28 from verse 16, the Bible says, "Then the 11 disciples went away into Galilee to the mountain which Jesus had appointed for them." Now, this is very interesting. I may pause a little here and say this. You will notice here that the Bible says that to the mountain which the Lord had appointed for them. How many of you can see that? That there is a mountain that the Lord had appointed. Now, how many of you know that this mountain was in Jerusalem? It was in Israel. But the Lord did not appoint for them every mountain. Now, this is very, very essential. In this particular place, this men that the Lord was about to give the commission to, these were not crowds that followed Him. These were disciples. And one of the first mark of a disciple is that he understands how to receive and comply with instruction. A disciple that is matured, one of the evidence of a mature disciple is the ability to receive instruction. That once you refuse or you do not allow yourself to learn how to receive instruction from the Lord, you can begin to realize that you will be ineffectiveness and barren in spiritual things. So there's a mountain that the Lord had appointed to them. It was not mountain A, it was not mountain B. Let's say it was mountain C. So what happens to the disciple that after the Lord had appointed mountain C, he goes to mountain B and says, but they are all mountains and they are mountains in Jerusalem. So people that believe that Christianity has no absolutes don't know the Bible. People that believe that God, that the gospel of grace does not have definiteness and does not have specific positions on certain matters do not understand a walk with God, and they are going to meet unpleasant surprises when they stand before Jesus. That concerning your life as a disciple of Jesus, there is an instruction from the very beginning on the mountain you should go to. You cannot go to every mountain. And then the Bible tells us that when they saw him, they worshipped him, but some doubted. And Jesus came and spoke to them, saying, all authority has been given to me in heaven and on earth. Go therefore and make disciples of all the nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father, of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit, teaching them to observe all the things I have commanded you. Lo, I am with you always, even till the end of the age. Now, this is the context of the last day church ministry and assignment. This is what our assignment is. Every man that God calls today, no matter how he tries to frame his vision and mission will come out from this. If he does not reflect this, he's going to fail the exam ultimately. Am I communicating? If a believer gets up and says, the Lord has called me to make other believers prosperous, and in the teaching of that prosperity, there is no reflection of the prosperity within the context of this word, this mandate, that man who is claiming that the Lord has sent him to teach prosperity has failed. Amen? Am I communicating with you? Okay? If a man gets up and says, the Lord has called me to teach righteousness, the teaching of righteousness must be within the context of the final instruction that Jesus gave to the church, to the disciples. And who did he give these disciples to? Who are the one in position to be able to execute this mandate? They are called disciples, they are not just Christians. The word disciple is an extract from the word discipline. One who acquires the discipline of another, who lives by that discipline. And so he said that all authority in heaven and earth has been given to me. And I am saying now, go therefore into the world and make disciples of all nations. This is what you and I have been called to do. We have been called to make disciples of all nations. Now, let me explain this to you. Ultimately, when a child is young, one of the qualities or characteristics of a child is that a child is selfish. When you have a newborn baby, if the baby is 2 months old, 3 months old, the baby does not care for anybody. The baby cares only for himself. And so the baby will cry. When he wants to eat, he cries. When he wants to sleep and he's fighting sleep, he cries. When he poo-poos, he does not apologize, he cries. When he wee-wees, he doesn't apologize, he cries. If he woos, if the baby wee-wees on you, the baby still does not render an apology, the baby cries. And when you look at many of God's people, they are babies. They wee-wee, they cry. They poo-poo, they cry. Now the problem is that babies don't go to war. But in the realm of the spirit and the things of the spirit, a Christian that is still a baby is still part of spiritual warfare. Am I communicating with you? Now, the plan of God is for us to move away from being babies to becoming disciples. And every teaching must point at Jesus. And the interpretation, the use, the objective of every teaching in relation to Jesus must be to the end that we are making disciples of nations. Now understand what Jesus said to us. We make disciples of nations. He didn't just say we should make disciples. It simply means that we should bring nations under in subjection to the principles of the kingdom of Christ. So what happens to a Christian that after he has given his life to Christ, the next 25 years, all his prayer is, Lord, every power of darkness, let it fall down. Lord, let my life be okay. Lord, let my children live well. Lord, let everything will be well with me. Oh, Lord, I want to buy a car. When he buys a car, he says, Lord, I want a house. When he gets a house, he says, Lord, I want to have children. When they have children, he says, Lord, let my children have children. When the children have children, he says, Lord. And then he says, Lord, I want to die. And then he dies. When that believer stands before God, do you think that he would have passed the test of his life on earth? No. Even if he lived a holy life, he would not have passed. That the objective of God for sending the Lord Jesus into the earth was the salvation of the human race. And the strategy of God is the discipling of nations, where disciple make disciples. Now, Jesus expects that as he has saved us through the work of the cross and the witness and conviction of the Holy Spirit, that we also, as believers, our gaze is supposed to be on the nations, not just on our locality, not just on our environment. When God looks at Tunisia, he's looking for believers that will rise up and go and take Tunisia. When God looks at Malaysia, he's looking for believers that will rise up and go and take Malaysia. When God looks at Iraq, he's not intent that the culture of the kingdom or the gospel of the kingdom will penetrate Iraq and rearrange the culture of Iraq. So we have been called to make disciples of what? Of families? Of nations. Amen. It also implies that your Christianity cannot be localized Christianity. It cannot be just something that is limited to your environment. That if Christianity, if that instruction is correct, Christianity is supposed to influence the politics and the economies of nations. And when you read the Bible and see men in the Old Testament who were spirit-filled, you will see at different times the inworking of the Holy Spirit in the life of some of the Old Testament believers, how it influenced politics and policies, and the victory that emanated, the weakness of the kingdom of darkness, when you compare it to the power of the Holy Spirit at work in the believer, how he gave glory to God and pointed and witnessed to Jesus. So when Joseph interpreted the dream of Pharaoh and came up with economic policies from the dream of Pharaoh, and told Pharaoh, this is what you do, appoint a man, let him do this, let him do this, let him do that. What did Pharaoh say? There is no other man in Egypt that is as wise as you. So he called him Zaphnath-Paaneah. God lives and he speaks. Did Joseph need to go to Pharaoh and say, give your life to Christ or you go to hellfire? Salvation is better than any desire. Most people don't know that line. That's Junior Pretty. That's some holding this song. It was a rap. That was the way somebody was toasting a lady. Amen. Joseph didn't need to go to Pharaoh. So, in the discipling of nations, there are certain things that need to be understood. There's the place of bearing witness to the gospel through explaining. Sir, can I share Christ with you? Can I talk to you about Jesus? There's a place like that. There's another place where your classmate comes and says, you know what? I've observed you. When I was in level 2, University of Lagos, I came in through the director, and a young man walked up to me, one of our classmates. all the guys, most brilliant guys in Asset. After about 2 months, he came to me and said, you know what, are you a Christian? I said, what kind of question is that? Everybody should be something. He said, but are you a pastor? I said, yeah, well, people call me pastor, I'm born in Christ. He said, hey, I knew. The Bible says, in him was life, and the life was the light of men. That the life you live is illuminated by the power of the Holy Spirit within, and it bears witness. So the discipling of nations is not just the profession of Christ, it's not just the congregation of or the assembling of believers. It is from the witness, from mouth-to-mouth witness to life witness, to understanding how the equipment of the kingdom given to us is to be administrated. And one of the things given to us, my friend, is the name of Jesus. Amen? Let's go back a bit. In 1 Samuel chapter 17, we see David here getting ready to stand in battle against Goliath. Now, I also want to say to you that, like we were looking at in the upper room, I said what you know and what you don't know can hurt you. They can take a lot away from you. In this particular passage here, Goliath had stood in front of the children of Israel for 40 days. And he had been making boast and making noise and screaming and shouting, and he had been oppressive of them. Now understand that Goliath was a very, very tall man. Amen? And then the scripture tells us that not a single man in the whole of Israel came out to stand against Goliath. But there was a young man who was in his father's house, and he was taking care of the flock, the sheep, you know, and all of that. And the Bible says that the father sent him on errand. And the father sending him on errand, David got down to the battlefront, and he saw that there was something happening. And he had Goliath, you know, speaking pompous words against God and speaking against God's people. And not only was Goliath just speaking, Goliath was defying God. He was defying Israel. It's like saying that, which stupid God are you people saying you are calling? Which useless Jesus are you calling? Have you had people say that? Especially when you meet children that are from a family with alternative religion. Oh, get out. Which useless God are you calling? Goliath said all sorts of things. And the Bible says that there was nobody strong enough that could come out to defend the dignity and the glory of God. I want to pray for you today. The prayer that Paul prayed for the Ephesian church, that the eyes of your understanding will be enlightened. Amen. That you will have the revelation of God, of you have the revelation, knowledge of God in Christ Jesus.
Amen.
That everything that concerns you, you will see the way God sees.
Amen.
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 And so the Bible tells us that David got down there, and David eventually went down to Saul and said, you know what, I'm going to fight this man. And I said, no, you can't fight him. He's been a warrior from his youth. He's going to destroy, he's going to kill you. David said, don't worry. The God that gave the bear and the lion into my hands, what will that God do? He will give these uncircumcised Philistines to me. Now understand, before David came on the scene, nobody called Goliath uncircumcised. I want to say that some people will get to certain quarters, and what they see will make them turn back. Some other people will get there. The very thing that made other people turn back is what will make them jump in. And that your sight, your revelation of a situation is very, very important. And so the scripture tells us that, well, Saul eventually will let him go. And when Goliath saw David, Goliath said something like, am I a dog? Now I want you to also understand that the battles of life, the warfare of life, both natural and in the spirit, are warfare of words. It is one of the reasons why a man that keeps quiet, if you are not meditating in your heart so that your mouth can, when it opens, it says the right things, you're already a defeated man. You must practice how to talk. And not just talk, you must practice saying the right things. So Goliath stands up and says, am I a dog that you should send this one to me? And guess what David said? David said, let's go into the Bible and read it, because we're Bible study. 1 Samuel chapter 17. I'll read from verse 41. So the Philistine came and began drawing near to David, and the man who bore the shield went before him. I want you to see that it took a whole man to carry the shield of Goliath. It took a whole man to carry the shield of Goliath. Now, this is usually how problems in life pose. Problems in life pose insurmountable. Problems in life pose very, very big, giant one. There are attachments and indexes of problems that suggest to you that you are not going to overcome as a child of God. Understand that every attack of the enemy against your person is not really about your person, other than about the assignment that Jesus has given to his church, which is disciple the nations. So the enemy comes through personal challenges in your life to incapacitate you, so that by incapacitating you, he would have incapacitated God, and he would have further made it impossible for that commission that Jesus gave to us to happen. Am I communicating with you? So if it's like when the enemy comes and stabs a child of God in the back, the child of God may turn and see the enemy. The child of God makes a mistake when he begins to think that the battle between him and the enemy is a personal battle. Most of the times, God's people fail in warfare, in every given situation they may find themselves, because they narrow down every negative experience to a personal experience. Warfare in the spirit is not first about you and the devil. If you don't understand that, you are failed. Because if you narrow it down to you and the devil, you will have to look for weapons in yourself to fight the devil. And there is no weapon you have that can withstand the dragon. The Bible calls him the ancient dragon. The scripture describes him as Leviathan. The Bible calls him the old serpent. The names by which devil is described are names that naturally strike fear. And I've told you, the most powerful demon in hell is not hell, is not the spirit of hell, is not the spirit of death. The most powerful spirit in the realm of darkness is the spirit of fear. Because it's the spirit that incapacitates. It doesn't necessarily kill you, it just incapacitates you. It makes you believe that what is not is. And so that the more you believe that what is not is, what is not eventually will be. Do you understand what I'm saying? So you got up and they told you that when a woman wakes up in the morning and she's sweating very heavily, it means she has cancer. Now, that's just an hypothesis. I don't know how true that is. So don't quote me. And then you wake up and you begin to sweat. The first day you sweat. The second day you sweat. And then as you turn on the TV, there was a documentary. And the woman comes up and says, well, my name is Dr. So-so-and-so-so-and-so. Today, I want to talk about cancer. And I want to tell you, women, especially, you need to be careful. When you wake up in the morning and you find yourself sweating, this may be a symptom of the first stage of cancer. And then you realize that you were sweating the first stage. You know, there are things that happen that they look like, and you start sweating more. You know, there are things that happen that they look like coincidence. Am I communicating with you? It happens to me a lot. There are times maybe I just had a back pain and, you know, I was just stretching. And I lay hold on my phone and open my phone and I go to YouTube. And the first video I'm looking at is fixing back pain in 1 minute. It happens to me a lot. And I know it's not just me. And so the enemy wants to make you narrow down that warfare. Understand, the inability to put food on the table for the family between you and the devil. It is an attack against the sacred order of Jesus. So, if I sent my son on errand and said, go and buy bread. And he goes to buy bread. And on his way to buy bread, somebody sees him and harasses him and collects the money. What do you think the first inclination of my son will be? Eh? The money is not for me. The first thing is his mind will go to the person that sent him. Now, this is one of the areas where you realize that most of God's children don't have a revelation of the fatherhood of God. Because of their relationship with their earthly father, there are many children that if their father sent them on an errand and somebody beat them and collect the money from them, the boy will sit on the road and say, my father will kill me. So he doesn't go to his father. Meanwhile, the person that took the money from him, that money is not his own. He didn't work for that money. The person that took that money from him, in reality, is not having a conflict with the boy. The person has challenged the person that sends the boy. So the fight is the fight between the father and the person that took the money. So your inability as a child of God to do the good things of life, or you get to a point in your life and the struggle appears to be endless, understand, it is not you. It is not about you. This warfare is about you. It's about God and the forces of darkness. But what does the spirit of fear do? The spirit of fear makes you begin, hey, they want to kill me. Oh. They will kill me. Oh. They want to kill me. Oh. They will kill me. Oh. They want to kill. And then you begin to make wrong confessions. And the enemy actually says, thank you. For the Bible says, by the words of your mouth, you will be judged. The Bible says that the power of life and death is in the tongue, and those that love it will eat of the fruit thereof. And so many of God's children have died useless death because of this. Am I communicating with you? However, David here gives to us a very vital principle. Goliath says, verse 44, and the Philistine said to David, come to me, and I will give you the flesh, and I will give your flesh to the birds of the air and the beasts of the field. Then David said to the Philistines, you come to me with sword and spear and with javelin. I could sit down and try to see what the spiritual meaning of each of those equipments are to you. The devil is a master at launching offensive attacks. A spear, a sword, a javelin. How many of you know that you don't throw swords? You could throw a sword, but really, a sword is a weapon of close contact. A spear and a javelin are long-distance offensive weapons. We'll leave that for another time and explain that. Let's go. So David says that you came to me with a sword, a spear, and with a javelin, but I come to you in the name of the Lord of hosts, the God of the armies of Israel, whom you have defied. Ah. Okay, so let's look at something interesting. So I'm praying for you again that the eyes of your understanding will be enlightened.
Amen.
And that your sight, your understanding, your interpretations will be according to the revelation knowledge that is in Christ Jesus.
Amen.
How is it possible that you stand in front of a man that carries AK-47? And the man says, I'm going to kill you. And you tell the man, you are holding catapults. Because that's exactly what is happening here. You are holding catapults. The man is looking at the catapult in your hand and he's saying, am I a dog that you come to me with catapult? Ah, I'm going to destroy your life today. And then you tell him, it is the catapult you are looking at, but the catapult is really not the weapon of warfare. The real weapon of warfare is the name of the God of the armies of Israel that you have defied. Now, you must never put the responsibility of your victory in anything material. Understand, the Lord will always walk through material things, but it is not the material things themselves that accomplishes the victory. It is the spiritual force, the life that invades the material thing. So that when David flung the first stone, the only place that is opened is where the stone went through. Now, that can be a coincidence. That can be an accident. But because if you understand that the Lord does not miss, amen? How many of you have had people say that, oh, when they were so sin, when they die, God will fling them, he'll fling them over hellfire. And I said to them, you see, you are either not a Christian or your pastor didn't teach you well. God does not miss. If God was in the business of flinging, if he flung you and he missed, hell will get up and go and collect you. Because everything on earth is designed to obey his intention and his injunction. And the Bible tells us in the book of Isaiah, hell beneath has enlarged itself to receive you. So David says here that I come against you in the name of the Lord of the armies of Israel that you defy. This is an Old Testament saint. And then David goes further to tell him something extra. This day, the Lord will deliver you into my hands, and I will strike you, and I will take your head from you. And this day, I will give your carcass to the camp of the Philistines, of the birds, of the air, the wild beast of the earth, that all the earth may know that there is a God in Israel. Ah, see warfare. Now, there are some things in this text that is drawing me away. Do you know that the final outcome of your life, really, again, is not about you? That when the objective of your anger and your warfare is the glory of God, heaven is put at attention to come in for you. Have you ever felt that you're failing an exam is something that blasphemes the Lord's glory? Have you ever considered that you not being able to maximize the things that the Lord has given to you, that the failures, the failings, and you not shining as light in an unbelieving environment, whether due to your own poor or your own making or other forces outside of you, really is not just about you, it's about the fact that God is not glorified by this thing. So David said, look, it's not about me. The world needs to know that there is a God in Israel. And you know what? By those utterances, David brought God's commitment to the battlefield. Amen? By those utterances, David brought God's commitment to the battlefield. Now, we've not gotten to the New Testament to see the name of Jesus. Now, understand that in the olden days, the name of a king was everything, represented the consummation of all the power and authority that is vested by the constitution in that kingdom. So, let's say we're living 2,000 years ago, and the name of our king is King Buhari of Niger. If King Buhari sends somebody, if a man comes to your house, for those of you who watch Robin Hood, Robin of Locksley, if an army, a soldier comes into your house and he says, I come to you in the name of King, what's that name? Pentagon or Pentadragon, something like that. And he says, I come to you in the name of King Jaja of Okpobo, and is, let's say you are in Okpobo, and he says, I come to you in the name of Jaja of Okpobo. That soldier has brought the entire state force against you. If you are being summoned, that you would have to follow me, you have the right to ask him, by whose authority am I supposed to follow you? He said, I come in the authority of King Jaja of Okpobo. Once you have had that name, not to follow, even if you are right, not to follow means death. It means rebellion. So when David came to the battlefield and said, I come to you in the name of the Lord of the armies. Now, this is another issue. The Lord came to Abraham and revealed himself to Abraham. But when the Lord was going to reveal himself to Moses, the Lord came to Moses and said, by my name, the Lord, I did not reveal myself to your fathers. But this revelation is a dimension of my glory revealed to you. Now understand that when you talk about God's glory, there's a difference between the glory of God and anointing. Anointing comes in measures. A man can carry the anointing of the Holy Ghost for healing, and he lays hands on you, and after 1 hour, you are healed. The healing can be gradual. Some other people carry anointing at a greater measure. But when you talk about the glory of God, the glory of God does not come in measure. The glory of God is in dimensions. And when it comes in fullness. Am I communicating with you? When he leaves, he leaves. When he comes, he comes. So, when David said, I come to you in the name of the Lord of the armies of Israel, he was evoking a thing about the commander of the armies, the most lethal offensive striker in heaven, on earth, and the earth beneath. You should know that Goliath, at that point, Goliath would have just dropped the spear, the sword, and started running. But because he was blind, he waited. And I told you, you know, at the upper room retreat, I told you that blindness is a weapon of warfare. And the Lord of the armies of Israel is full of different weapons in his arsenal. You know, you won't find him on the warfare fighting his sword. Bah, 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 bah. I say, No. He just said, all right, spirit of blindness, go. It's okay, oh. Spirit of deafness, go. Don't let him hear when the car is coming. He will cross when the car is coming. And then he crosses. Bah! Didn't you hear that the car was on it? Didn't hear. The spirit of deafness attacked him because he had ganged up against the righteous man, the child of God. Warfare. Now, but the important thing I need you to know here is that David said, in the name of the Lord. That name is important. If you narrow that down to the New Testament, we are talking here now about the name of Jesus. In law, there is something called the power of attorney. It means that someone has been given the permission to be your representative in the court of law. So a lawyer comes to court, and the judge sits down, and the lawyer says, well, Your lordship, my name is so-so and so-so and so. I'm the solicitor and the barrister representing Mrs. and Mr. so-so and so. In the court of law, it is admissible that you don't represent yourself. It is admissible that you look for someone more competent and proficient to represent your cause. What Jesus did for you and I is beyond comprehension. A quick insight into the covenant of works and the covenant of grace. And into what Jesus did. Now, when Adam fell in the garden, something serious happened. Rebellion was instituted and the gateway for sin was established. Man had fallen, and he was the one that God gave the authority, the legitimate authority to have dominion over the earth. Now, man has committed high treason. He has sinned against the authority that installed him. Am I communicating with you? And on the account of that sin, death also gained access into the earth realm. Now, man is in bondage. God has an option. He will either punish man by killing him, or he will seek out an alternative so that man wouldn't die, that alternative is established until the sin that has been committed can be fully paid for. So what God did was, in the garden, the Bible tells us that when man sinned and God came, a man said he was naked. God said, how do you know you are naked? That knowledge is not of the tree of life. That knowledge is of the tree of the knowledge of good and evil. Have you eaten of the thing, the tree I told you not to eat? We will get there another time, because there are things you must not eat from as God's children. The tree of the knowledge of evil is still in the earth, and people eat from it. It looks nice. It is usually attractive. It is seductive in nature. It is a kind of knowledge that pretends to be the knowledge, the revelation knowledge of Christ Jesus, because many times it still hangs within the garden that the Lord planted. It is also the reason why it is great danger when we leave the word of God and seek to disciple believers by many other means apart from the scriptures. When we raise other standards in the house of God, other than the standard of the word. When Christians come to Bible study, but they don't bring Bible. It's true. As great as technology is, it has turned out in certain areas for advantage and for disadvantage. There are Christians that they just know that when we get Bible study, they will stream it live on the screen. So they don't go with Bible. And that's the only opportunity for them to open their Bible in the week. Once they step out of Bible study, forget it, there's no Bible. Back now. Now the Bible tells us that immediately man sinned, he went to hide himself. So the scripture says the Lord took the skin of an animal and he covered them. Now, you cannot have the skin of an animal except an animal has been killed. Are you following me? What we are talking about here is the knowledge for living on the face of the earth victoriously. I told you earlier that Jesus Christ has accomplished victory for us. Our victory in Christ Jesus is a finished work by the cross. Am I communicating with you? But the manifestation of that victory in our day-to-day living is a function of the revelation knowledge in Christ Jesus that we have. And if we don't have that revelation knowledge, the enemy is going to have a field day. You can be wealthy in the bank and be walking on the street like a poor man, eating from the dunghill. The Bible says that my people perish for lack of knowledge. Am I communicating with you? Before I go further, many years ago, this probably will be maybe a 2000. Was it a 2000? Like 2000 and 2003. I was at home and I was in a dream. And in this particular dream, I saw myself at the gate of our estate, and I was going to invite Pastor E. Adewe for a meeting. Now, don't forget, it's a dream, it's not real life. I was going to invite Pastor Yadewe for a meeting, and I began to go. And when I got to the bus stop, I got into this bus that was a coaster bus. It was white. And when I got into the bus, I just started talking. You know, I was just talking and talking and talking. Everybody in the bus were quiet and they were listening. But after talking for a while, I noticed that nobody in the bus was blinking. That their eyes were just like this. Was just open, it wasn't blinking. Then it occurred to me that all these people are dead people. And all of a sudden, immediately I realized that I find myself in a cemetery in the company of these people. And a procession, I found myself locked in a procession with them. And it felt like we're on that procession in this cemetery, we climbed on top of a tomb and descended through the tomb into the underground. That the tomb was actually a gate into the underworld. And I was locked in their midst. And as we descended the staircase, at a point in the descent, the people that were in front of me suddenly disappeared. And I was the number one person standing in front. And all of a sudden, there was an ugly demon standing in front of me. And in that dream, I said, in the name of Jesus, I punched him once. The punch didn't appear to shake him. And then I screamed again, in the name of Jesus. I punched him the second punch. The left leg moved backwards slightly. And then I screamed the third time, in the name of Jesus. I punched him the third time. He fell backwards and he disappeared. And I woke up. When I woke up, it was around 12 in the morning. At night, like, you know, 12 a.m. And my room was filled with fear. The fear was so real. Like I felt the presence of the cemetery in the room. And so instantly, my spirit started racing. What scripture? What scripture? What scripture? What scripture? What we watch? So I just remembered Matthew chapter 28, this verse, that go into the nations, make disciples of all nations. Lo, I am with you. Baptizing them in the name of the Father, of the Son, of the Holy Spirit. Lo, I am with you till the end of the age. Instantly, I just started confessing that scripture. Lord, you said you are with me till the end of the age. Lord, you said, and for like 30 minutes, 1 hour, that was my confession, and the atmosphere got lifted. And all of a sudden, I felt the power of the Holy Spirit all over me. In that dream, I didn't just punch the man. I punched that demon with the name of Jesus. Now, when Jesus said, all authority in heaven and on earth has been given to me, go and make disciples of all nations. If Jesus owns authority in heaven, everything, and he owns all the authority on the earth, everything, is there supposed to be a nation that can resist a representative of the one that has all the authority in heaven and on the earth? Do you understand what I'm saying? If all the authority in heaven and on earth is consummated in Christ, and Jesus says that, I have given you that authority as my representative, I now have that authority, should America resist me? Should the United Kingdom resist me? You don't understand, yeah? The way you are looking. Or it's too good to be true. Because that's the problem. If you don't believe it, it doesn't work. Did you notice that after Jesus appeared to them the third time? Peter said, Jesus appeared the first time. He appeared the second time after Thomas misbehaved. And then the third time, you see that even on the Mount of Transfiguration before he left, when he was giving them the final command, some people still did not believe. That seeing him in his post-resurrected body, in his glorified body, some people still did not believe. So it is confirmed. There are Christians that will be defeated in this world. That the experience of their earthly journey will be that of defeat. Not because Jesus didn't die for them, but because they could not believe. The Bible says that those to whom the gospel was first preached to did not mix it with faith in their heart, so they couldn't enter into the rest of God. Now, in the rest of God, the provisions are prepared. Now understand, when the Bible says they couldn't enter into the rest of God, it means that they had to begin to create their own works. They could not enter into the finished works of Christ. So what does that mean? On the first day, God created. On the second day, God created. On the third day, God created. On the fourth day, God created. On the fifth day, God created. On the sixth day, God created. On the seventh day, God rested. So you see, the work of God is behind him. The rest of God is before him. The man that cannot enter into the rest of God will remain where? You remain in the work of God. Now, the problem is that work, he cannot do that work because only God can do his own work. So the man who, by faith, is not entering into God's rest is by unbelief creating his own works. And the works of men cannot lead into the rest of God. So that means that such a man we live perpetually in the realm and in the regions of struggles. Do you understand? Am I communicating with you? This morning, I was going out. I was going to see my mechanic. And when I began to approach his shop, to the right is the local planning authority, the local government council. In my spirit, I had turned into the council. I'd worked in the council there, maybe some 15, 20 years ago. Turned into the council. And I was obliged to turn in. There was grace in my heart to turn in. But that's his shop there. His shop is opposite the council. So I parked. And I got down. We didn't turn into the council. I walked to his shop. And when I got to his shop, they came out to greet me, Pastor. And he said, Fatai, he has gone into the council. Then it occurred to me that it came to my heart to turn into the council for no obvious reason. It's not like there's traffic. It's not like there's no parking space in his shop. It's not like there was hold up or there was trouble. Because people will run into the council if there's nowhere to park. But I just had the impression, turn into the council. Now you see, the Lord who sees Fatai, the Lord that is in 1 hour to come, that is in 7 days to come, and that is in yesterday, is where I am in the minute. Is where Fatai is in the same minute. He's already in where Fatai will be in the next 2 hours. And before that next 2 hours, he's saying to me, turn to the council. But because I didn't pay attention to it, I still got down from the car. And then I now walked to Fatai's shop, only to be told in Fatai's shop, Fatai is in the council, only for me to now walk back towards the car, and then now try to drive and face the council. If, when I was coming, I just drove into the council, as I'm driving into the council, I'll be meeting Fatai on the way. Do you see all the rigmarole I had to go through because I didn't listen to that voice? That is what unbelief does. It makes you recreate your works, and they are usually barren works. They are fruitful works. It is one of the reasons why if there is any subject a child of God should master, if there is any subject a child of God should practice deliberately, it is how to recognize the leading of the Holy Ghost. When there's an inner witness in your heart and it doesn't make sense, don't worry about it. It's okay to make mistakes. Deliberately trying to follow him. Am I communicating with you? Huh? Lord, help us. So, still talking about what Jesus did for us, so that you can understand the name of Jesus. The Bible now tells us that a lamb was killed. The scripture didn't write that out clearly, but when you see them covered with a sheepskin, it means that an animal died and blood was shed. Because wherever sin has been committed, judgment must come. So the animal bore the sin, the judgment for the sin of man. But because man and animal are not on the same level, the blood of animal could not make a complete atonement for the sin of man. It just covered that sin so that at the right time or at the fullness of time, it will be revisited again. So even within the Aaronic priesthood, men had to go every year to make sacrifice for their sin by taking an animal to the high priest. Then the high priest would put his hands and put the hands of the sinner, transfer the sin of the man to the animal, and then he would kill the animal. He would take the animal outside the camp and he would kill the animal. And so Jesus, when Jesus came, Jesus had to die outside of the camp. Now understand, for Jesus, it was not as simple as for you and I. Man has sinned. Man, the covenant that God cut with Israel, the first covenant was a covenant of works. He gave them the Ten Commandments. And by the means of strength, the Bible tells us, no man will prevail. There is no man that can accomplish the covenant, that can accomplish righteousness by works. Because you see, sin was working in the body of man. Am I communicating with you? Sin, the sin nature was a new programming. How many of you know that everything works according to program? If you turn your phone on now, if it is Samsung, it will do well, and then it will show Samsung. That is the programming. To try and alter that programming by yourself, by just pressing button, it will not work. So the new programming, as a result of the fall, is the lust of the flesh, the lust of the eye, and the pride of life. These are the programmings that was at work in man. And the man was trying to live a holy life by keeping the law. So it is impossible. So a man will see a woman like this, and his eyes will begin to roam. Alright? And then the woman passed. He cannot do anything to help himself from misbehaving. After he's done misbehaving, he feels bad. Oh, I've misbehaved. I need to have sinned. So he takes an animal to the priest. And then the priest transfers his sin to the animal. Kill the animal. But the sin in the sacrifice of that animal, the programming has still not been corrected. The sin, judgment for the sin has been placed. But the programming that caused the sin has not been corrected. So the man only goes back, only to do what? To sin again. Am I communicating with you? So, the person that is going to offer the sacrifice that will be acceptable, this one cannot be a sheep. He has to be a man. And for him to be, to offer an acceptable sacrifice, he himself cannot sin, because then he will be punished for his own sin. If he's going to be a representative of the people, he must come under the same condition that the people are living under. He must not come under a superior condition. So when Jesus came into the earth, Jesus did not come under the covenant of grace. He also came under the covenant of the law. And he said, I have not come to abolish the law. I have come to fulfill all of it. The Bible says that he was tempted in all ways, yet he did not sin. The very thing that many men fell to, Jesus did not fall to it. So he was under the law. He was tempted in all ways. He did not sin. Huh? So he could not be punished for his own sin because he had none. Am I communicating with you? So he has passed one mark now. Now, the second thing now is that since he walked under the law and was tempted in every way and he did not sin, that means that God could not punish Jesus for the sin of Jesus. He had none. Now, for Jesus to deliver mankind, Jesus now has to suffer the punishment of the violation of the law, because the people he is representing are law breakers. They have not been punished. Jesus can represent them since he walked like them and he did not sin. So you need someone to be punished for the sin of others. Jesus is qualified. So Jesus honored the law. He did not violate it. But he must suffer the wrath of the law because he's standing as a representative for those that violated it. Now, so when he comes under the wrath of the law to be punished for the sins that others have committed, the anger of God is pacified. Now, the next thing now is that anyone that now stands in Jesus, all right, every person that Jesus now represents, now Jesus, now don't forget, he has suffered the consequence of law violated. And so God is happy. Now, the Bible now tells us that now that God is happy, the next thing is that God now gave him a name that is above every other name. That in the name of Jesus, every knee should what? Should bow. Every tongue should what? Should confess. Now, Jesus continues to live.
So anyone, since he was able to represent people for their sin, people also can now believe on him for their righteousness and for their blessedness. Which means that if anyone now come and say, Jesus, I believe in you for all that you have done. I believe you, and I believe that the work you did it for me. Since he was able to take their sin, they are entitled, they have a right by faith to take his blessedness, his righteousness, and appropriate it to themselves, even though, basically, they are incapable of such righteousness. Am I communicating with you? And so the first thing when you say a child of God is righteous, is not righteousness by works, is imputed righteousness. The Bible says that he that knew no sin became sin, that we may become the righteousness of God, that we through him may become the righteousness of God in Christ Jesus. Now, when you go to Philippians chapter 2, you will find out that something was given to Jesus as a reward. He's worthy of our reading. Philippians chapter 2 from verse 5. He says, verse 5. Let this mind be in you, which also was in Christ Jesus, who being in the form of God. Now this is the condescension, the double condescension of Christ. What did I call it? And you'll find out the glorious, the blessedness of our Lord Jesus Christ and the blessedness of being his people. You know, when you say humble yourself, you say, oh, humble yourself. A man humbling himself is not a big deal. But a God humbling himself is all deal. Because what Jesus did was that, for Jesus to come and die for you and I, and take that position, the first thing was that he had to empty himself of glory. The Bible says that he did not consider equality with God something to be grasped. What does that mean? God, Jesus and God were the same on all levels. Jesus, God and the Holy Spirit were the same on all levels. The Father was not superior to the Son was not inferior to the Father, the Holy Spirit is not inferior to any of them. The Bible calls them the Godhead. People have said, but how can God not be superior to Jesus? That is the arrangement, that is the order. God give back to God. Lions give back to lions. If you follow the order of creation, the Father is initially strong. And then after some time, what happens? The Son begins to become stronger. But in the Godhead, there is no diminishing returns to the strength of the Father. There is no improvement in the strength of the Son, because they are both eternal. They are not even eternal beings. Eternity resides in them. So the Son is not weak in relation to the Father. The Father is not weak in the continuing existence of his Son. The Holy Spirit is not diminished by the presence of either of them. But in the Godhead, the Father stands in a higher position. Am I communicating with you? So the Bible says that when we look at this scripture critically, when there was a need for man to die, the Son, among the Trinity, offered himself. Okay, I'll go and die for them. For him to be a perfect sacrifice, he cannot die as God, because that's cheating. Am I communicating with you? If a child steals pencil, and you ask his father to come and collect koboko for him, can the child feel the pain? No. Another child can feel the pain. So Jesus had to come as a man. For him to come as a man, he can't come as a man with the heavenly glory. There will be nothing left on the earth. Everybody will run away. That's if his glory will not even burn the earth. Am I communicating with you? In the book of Revelation, Apostle John saw the glory of Christ and he fell. He says his eyes was like blazing fire.
His coal, his feet was like amber, coal or fire. His hair, white like Ancient of Days. The kind of whiteness that I've never seen anywhere. Jesus could not come like that. If he descended like that, who wants to nail him to the cross? There's nobody. So the first thing Jesus did was that he had to empty himself of that glory. To pour that glory out. And so he became ordinary. He emptied himself of the glory of God. There is a glory that is God. You know, when you see a king, they are kings of the earth. When you see kings in their glory and in their majesty, they wear the glory. But there's a way a king would... How many of you have watched Coming to America? It's a very old thing. Very old thing. He was the son of a king that traveled to America. And when he got to America, he decided to live like an ordinary man. So he opened the window and said, "Welcome to America!" And the first thing that happened was that somebody insulted him. "Close the door, idiot!" But you see, if it was in his country, nobody dared do that. Hey, the king, you call the king idiot, you are dead. And he started living like an ordinary man in America. And one day, he was trying to, you know, he was rolling with this particular girl and all of that and all of that. He still did not reveal his identity that he was a king until the day his father came. When his father came with all the entourage. When his father showed up like this, everyone was like, "What's happening?" I was like, "This glory is too much now." That was when he realized that he was a prince. Jesus emptied himself of glory. The first step in humility. After emptying himself of glory as God, he took the second step in humility. He came down to become a man. And when he came to become a man, the scripture says that he had no form of comeliness that anyone should desire him. Meant that he wasn't a ladies' man, Esther. It wasn't like Gabriel. Glory to God. On Sunday I was doing something, somebody said, one of these, "Pastor, you're just looking fine and fine every day." No, Jesus wasn't even looking like that. The Bible said he had no comeliness. He wasn't the most handsome man in Jerusalem. Everybody say the second condescension. Jesus humbled himself, the second stage. Then when Jesus was going to die for mankind, he didn't die in his sleep. An easy death. We are talking about the name of Jesus now. How he came about that name. And what that name is constituted of. Why the commitment of heaven, earth, and hell lines up behind that name. That even in hell, when that name is mentioned, things scatter. That name is the only name that when a man dies, and that name is sent on errand into the regions of the dead, the name will violate the law of grave and still collect the spirit of man, restore it into his body. Hell has that commitment to the name of Jesus. And friends, you need to understand this thing. You need to understand it. One of the reasons why Christianity is not working for many people is because their relationship with the things that pertains to their victory is a mental relationship. It's not a thing of the heart. As a girl, if a guy comes to you at the bus stop and says, "Mo love egoni, I love you. What would you say to him? Is he crazy? Although that line is the line you want to hear as a woman from a man you really, really love, you don't want that person playing with your heart and messing around with such serious words. "Esther, I love you. Sister, I love you. I love you." When you see a guy like that on the road doing that, what would you do? You run. You take cover. But if it's your husband, or, you know, a brother-in-law, and says, hey, well, holy brothers don't say I love you. I say, well, sister, I just want you to know that the Lord has been impressing upon my heart. Oh my good God. Oh Lord. But you cannot say love without the heart. Am I communicating with you? So Jesus did not choose to sleep in between two thieves and die. I said, God, I've emptied myself of my glory. I've humbled myself to become a man. Can I at least choose how I die? The Father chose his death. It was the death of the cross with plenty of shame. And he must die naked, hung on the cross. And Jesus went down the third step in the humility of Christ. He died on the cross with plenty suffering naked. And in the moment of that death, the worst thing on earth happened to him. The Father took his eyes away from him for the first time and the last time. So Jesus screamed, Elohim, Elohim, lama sabachthani, my Father, why have you forsaken me? The Father didn't leave the throne. The Son didn't leave the earth, but they were not seeing eye to eye. Jesus said, you have forsaken me. And then he said, to you, to your hand, I commit my spirit. Kai, when Jesus died, the veil in the temple tore open. Grave lost its power as the graves blasted open in Jerusalem. All over the world, not just in Jerusalem. The grave lost its power. Some of the saints, the Old Testament saints, came out. And the Bible says that they were seen in Jerusalem. It was the first time it was happening. His captives, the Son of God, has died. But he's not to be stopped there. He's going to rise. And that's where victory lies. Because now when he rises, every man that now believes on him is entitled to the blessedness of his righteousness. Without work. They did not work his death. They cannot work his righteousness. They must believe on his death, and then they will be qualified for his righteousness. So if you see myself, that girl, how can you say you are the righteousness of God in Christ Jesus? Look at all the foolishness and all the sins that you are struggling with. We are not condoning sin. Sin always produces shortage. But the struggle does not mean you are not righteous because you didn't work it. That righteousness is not your work. You are standing in the finished work of Christ. You don't just believe on Jesus. You believe on the work as being done for you. Now, but that is not just what happened. The Bible now tells us in Philippians chapter 2 that verse 8, and being found in the appearance as a man, he humbled himself and became obedient to the point of death, even the death of the cross. Therefore, God also has highly exalted him and given him what?
And giving him what?
Notice the Bible does not say a name. The Bible says the name. One of the ways, if you want to be a sound student of the word, one of the ways you see deeper things is when you look at names, look for their meaning. Because in the meaning of a name is captured or hidden or encoded a divine thought or a human thought. And every encoding has an entire vista in it. So the Bible says that therefore God gave him the name. Not a name. The name. there is a name that summons the heaven, the earth, and the earth beneath. And he says that at the name of Jesus, every knee should bow. And those of those in heaven, and of those on earth, and of those under the earth, and that every tongue should confess that Jesus is Lord, to the glory of the Father. Now understand, that Bible tells us in Isaiah that his name shall be called Emmanuel. But then, when he was going to be born, the Bible says his name will be called what? Jesus. But after the resurrection, he was no longer just Jesus. There was something peculiar now about this name. And you know the interesting about that name? That name Jesus is not just the name of the Son. It's actually the name of the Father. In the book of John chapter 16, it says, I have manifested your name to them. So that name, called Jesus now, in that name is all of the power and authority of God that brought the earth, the heavens, the earth beneath, that brought everything into existence. There is no iota of power anywhere within the throne of God or within the existence of the Almighty God that is left outside as a deposit reserved in case the name of Jesus fails. We can beckon to extra power. There is no other power outside of the name of Jesus. Now, when Jesus was going, he now came and said, all authority in heaven and earth has been given to me. Go in the name of the Father. That name that Jesus is given was the Father's name. That name has now become the Son's name. And because the executor of the new covenant is the Holy Ghost, he also bears that name. That name now, I have given that name to you. So when the Holy Spirit says, get up and go to Afghanistan, it's the Holy Spirit that says, get up. When you are going with that name. Nothing stands in the way of that name. When you are going with that name, the whole authority in heaven, the whole authority on the earth, the whole authority under the earth, everywhere it is constituted, is backing you up. So, men, situation, circumstances, non-living thing will play a role in the salvation of your journey. In ensuring that you have victory in everything you participate in. Am I communicating with you? You don't understand. Let me explain something to you. In the mid-90s, I was seeking admission. And I came to IK to collect my results. Before I left home, I knelt down and said, Lord, I'm going to YF office. Please, I need my results. Don't let me come back empty-handed. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen. I thought I had gotten to the YF office early. By the time I got to YF office around 9 o'clock, there were about 200 and something people on the line. And then I was still trying to deceive myself that I didn't know what the queue was about. So I asked somebody on the phone and said, please, what is this queue about? I said, those who came for results. I said, I knew there was no way I joined that queue, I get my result. There was no way. So I stood outside of the line and I was looking. And somebody said, you came for the result? Ross, come back tomorrow. You know where I stood? I said, but Lord, I told you I must not come back home without this result. That was my I was just having a conversation with myself there, with the Lord. And from nowhere, a man, dark in complexion, is still there. After 23 years, I went to see him some months ago. I asked after him, and he told me still there, and I saw him. And then I reminded him. The man just walked out of White House and was walking. And he came to me. I wasn't in the line. And he said, "What are you looking for?" I said, "Sir, it's my result. It's my result. I came late and they told me this is the line." And he said, "Follow me." And when we got to the gate, he told them, "He's with me." They had not started seeing people, attending to those on the line, those who came 6 o'clock, 5:30. They've not started attending to them. He took me in, printed my result, said, "Put it in your pocket and don't let anybody see it." And 30 minutes after, I was leaving 200 and something people on the queue that I met there. The man that the Lord used, he doesn't know me, I don't know him. Then I told the guy that said, "Come back tomorrow." I said, "You'll be here till tomorrow." Now, I'm a child of God. I have prayed to him before leaving home. How old was I? Maybe 16. My conversation with him wasn't a mental ascent. It was a real discussion. And I talked to you before leaving home. Honestly, the way I was very emotional. I said, "Well, Lord, I talked to you before I left home." And look at the testimony of that guy. "I will have to come back tomorrow." And when I was having that conversation with him, he had moved on a man in his office who had no business being outside. And the man came and led me in, printed the result, gave it to me, and I left everybody I met there. That is man responding to the backing of the authority of the name that I came with. It wasn't me responded to, it was the name of Jesus. There are times the wind will respond to you. There are times there are testimony if I tell you, you will think I'm lying. The Lord knows. And I'm saying to you today, now, what guarantees your victory as a child of God is a good understanding of that name. In that name, is the complete summation of everything that makes God, God. After you have exhausted everything in the name of Jesus, God will cease to be God if you don't get victory. Because it is inexhaustible. You are not just praying, saying, "Oh yeah, you are going to shout the name of Jesus 3 times. Or shout the name of Jesus 7 times. Jesus, 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 Jesus. Come, 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 come. Jesus, Jesus. Come, 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 Jesus, Jesus." And then it becomes play. But there's an understanding that when that understanding is battered in your heart, and you close your eyes and say, the name of Jesus, it's greater and higher than all names. It is not an ordinary name, it's the name that's full of power and praise. In the name, all sickness will bow. It is not an ordinary name, it's the name that's full of power and grace. Even the gate of prison opens at that name. Padlocks open. Many years ago, I was a teenager. And I went to my cousin's house, and for some reason I met my younger cousin at home. And I started witnessing Christ to her. Her name was Bumi. Started talking to Bumi about Jesus. And I was telling her, "You know, Jesus can do anything." And I said, "Jesus can do anything." I said, "Yes, Jesus can do anything." I said,
Bro, KEJI, that video has not been working for 3 months. Can Jesus do it? I said, Jesus can do it. He said, hey. Wait, I said, let's pray. Jesus can do it. Is that the reason why he says that unless you are like a child, you can't enter the kingdom? If it is now, I will tell him, take the video to your parents. Don't mock the Lord. And you know what? We prayed. And we picked the remote, turned the video on. It came on, and the video started working. You see, you are not impressed. You don't need to help God. Now, you see, the thing about God is, or the name of Jesus is, you cannot decorate it. It is a sin. So you cannot share a testimony that his name did not accomplish in a bid to assist the glory of his name. It's a crime. It's blasphemy. So the testimony I shared with you is true. The video started working. I'm going to stop here. If the Lord permits the next Bible study. Ah, look at people laughing. Oh, you have little faith. Amen. If the Lord permits, I will share why you don't get answer when you live in disobedience. Even when you pray in the name of Jesus. Because again, that is the problem. That you cannot rebel against the authority that constituted the earth and seek to use the same authority to achieve your means. It's like a car that is put in reverse and in forward simultaneously at the same time. It's a house divided against itself. It won't stand. Amen.
Amen.
Hallelujah.
Amen.
Ah, she met the grace. Do you understand? We've not even gotten to the topic. And then Jesus now begins to tell us different things about his name. The Bible says that the 70 went out, and when they came back, they said, Lord, demons were subject to us in your name. They had not even gone to the cross. He said, don't rejoice that demons are subject to you. I saw Satan fall from heaven like lightning. Rejoice that your name is written in the book of life. And then somewhere else, Jesus said, those who believe me in my name, they'll cast out demons. They'll handle serpents. If they drink anything that is poisonous, it won't hurt them. In your name. Why can't we do this thing without your name? Must we use your name? He's the one who lived under the covenant of works and did not commit a single sin. And yet, he suffered the wrath of the violation of the law. And so he's the only one who emptied himself of glory, humbled himself and took on the form of a man. Even as a man, he was not the most handsome of men. So that in all of his humility, no man could find any way to worship him without revelation. You know, when men are handsome, people worship handsome men. People worship handsome, beautiful women. When a woman is very beautiful, they use her for poster board. Say, beautiful girl. So they put her face on them. She does like this. They call them brand ambassador. That means, they want you to look that this girl is beautiful. While you're looking at the girl, you see their product. It's called idolatry. They call it branding. The Bible calls it idol worship. Because you will not just use any girl. If her teeth is broken in 10 different places, you won't use her on the poster. And yet, she's a girl created by God. So Jesus did not come as the most handsome man. Just came as a man. And then when he was going to die, he didn't choose the form of death. He died in between two thieves, fulfilling only the will of the Father. And the Father said, you just satisfied me completely. Now, this is my reward for you. Take the name. Now, that name is not just Jesus. That name is Lordship, the commander of everything. Everything. in heaven, on earth, and in hell. So you will see people who talk about having a revelation of seeing themselves in hell and the Lord was working with them. Because even in hell, the fire in hell can't burn him. The fire in hell loses his power and his sting when the Lord shows up, because he's the Lord of the fire. When grave sees him, grace loses his power, because grave can't hold him captive. He has fulfilled the pleasure of the authority that built the heaven and the earth, which he was the material used in the building. This message is going somewhere else. Why, when you as a child of God are living in sin, in disobedience, in fornication, in idolatry, in all of those things, nothing answers until you repent. Why repentance is not an Old Testament doctrine? That you cannot sin against authority and use the same authority at the same time. Do you see how you look at a policeman that collects bribe? Immediately collects the bribe. Instantly he strips himself of that authority. You see him as a useless man. That authority gives way. Immediately collects the bribe, he has become naked, although he's still wearing that uniform. What you see is just a yeah man, a stupid man. But if he stands in dignity and they're trying to give him one, I say, you're trying to bribe a police officer of the Federal Republic of Nigeria? Everybody begins to shake. Hey, oh boy, you don't enter Bagam. Because that is authority. But when he say, hey, now then I already give you. He has spoilt it. He has just spoilt it. Glory to Jesus. Amen. I want to have a different view of the name of the Lord. Special, great name. It's our tool. It's been given to you and I to do unbelievable things with. That's why I also said that some people are living lawlessly. And in some instances, the name of Jesus works even under lawless conditions. Say, Lord, in your name we cast out demons. Lord, in your name we work miracles. Lord, in your name we do this. If the Lord has not withdrawn his spirit from you, and you are trying to use his name, after some time, you'll find out that certain things don't work. But those guys, they did miracles, cast out demons, did signs and wonders, used his name, and when they met him, he said, I didn't know you. I never knew you. Depart from me, you who walk lawlessness, you who walk iniquity. Now, what is iniquity? Iniquity is the conflict of will. When the will of a man begins to wrestle with the will of God, and the will of that man supersedes the will of God. The Holy Spirit writing in the book of Ezekiel said that you were the anointed cherub that covered it until iniquity was found in you. Isaiah chapter 14, he said, I will raise my throne over the throne of God. Satan had a throne, but he was not satisfied. He wanted more. Glory to Jesus. Did you learn anything? Oh, such a joy. Let's give Jesus a round of applause.